Good morning, Northport. Welcome to Northport Community United Church of Christ. No matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you're always welcome here, and I do mean that. You're always welcome here. The attendance books, you want to sign those and pass them on, and then when they come back, read them and see if you know somebody or meet a new friend. Cell phones, if you could put them on silent mode or turn them off, because what Reverend Attila has to tell us is more important. The September newsletter is printed and available in the narthex. Donation for new underwear and socks for children will be collected between now and September the 18th. Please see the article in the newsletter. A special time recept care is looking for a new program director. See information in the bulletin. Come and join us on Friday at 9:45 to send off the Turning Point Youth Group for prayer as they leave for the weekend to Disney's Night of Joy, which is really a lot of fun, but we're going to miss it this year. Sunday school starts for children and adults on Rally Day, which is September the 20th, which is in 2 weeks. 2 weeks, yes. Midweek Bible study begins September 22nd at 11 o'clock. If that day and time is not good for you, please be interested in midweek study. Let the office know what days and time would work for you. Next Sunday's potluck. Bring a dish. What about dessert? You got desserts covered, Norma? She's not listening to me. That's all right. We'll be bringing a new members meeting on Sunday, October the 11th. Please read the orange insert in your bulletin to fill out the place and then the offer plate if you're interested in attending. Any other announcements? I know you got one, Norma. Come on.
Well, thank you, everybody, because you've all been busy, and you listened very good to all the announcements. The bins in the back are filling up. I just received a $50 donation, and I'm going to go out and spend a lot of money on clothes for the socks and underwear for the children for school. So this is awesome. I appreciate everything you guys do. I just thought I'd let you guys know. We have a visitor that was a member, still is a member, I guess, with us, Ruth Abels. She used to come and with her husband and sat in the third row for years and years. And then she kind of moved away, and now she's back amongst us. And I've been working 3 weeks to get her out of the nursing home and get her to church. So I am so pleased. She's just so vibrant and such a lovely, lovely lady. And I'm welcoming her back. Would you please help me welcome her back?
Okay. You might as well give your announcements too.
Good morning. So as Dave announced before, the Turning Point Youth Group is going on our annual Disney trip to Night of Joy, and we are leaving this Friday, and we would love it if as many people as possible can come and give us a send-off and pray with us as we head out to Disney for the weekend to listen to a bunch of Christian artists and have a lot of fun with the youth groups. So that will be at 9:45, and then one of my other announcements is I have found a workshop that's going to be at Pasa Grill Community Church, UCC. It's going to be on Saturday, October 3rd from 10 to 4. It is a workshop that is all about helping the church explore generational characteristics and how to work with all ages of the church. So if you're interested in coming with me to this workshop, it's going to be on October 4th. And it does cost $40, which covers your lunch and also the materials that they will be handing out as well. Oh, October 3rd. I'm sorry. It's October 3rd. And the next announcement that I do not have a slide for is for a concert, which is for King and Country. It will be in Punta Gorda on October 14th. It's going to be at the Charlotte Harbor Event Center. If we are able to get a group of 10 or more to go to this concert, it's going to be $20 a person. If not, then it's going to be $25. So if you're interested in joining me as well for the King and Country concert, that will be in the Charlotte Harbor Event Center, please come see me. Thank you.
What's the date on that?
October 14th.
Okay. Happening this week, junior choir today at 11:30, Turning Point at 6 p.m. Labor Day, the church will be closed for observance of Labor Day. Tuesday, we have bells at 4:30 and trustees at 6:30. Wednesday, we have open prayer at 7 o'clock. How's that going, Dave? Very good. And of course, as she just talked about, Turning Point leaving Friday night. Friday morning, 9:45. I'm not here. Is there any other announcements? Let us be at worship. We have any first-time visitors? I didn't think so. All right.
Out of practice.
Good morning and welcome to our worship service. Matthew 5:9 says, God blesses those who work for peace, for they will be called the children of God. We'll have the presentation of the flags.
Come, let us worship our God together. Come, join the circle with all God's creation. This is the day that God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And please be seated.
And I'm going to ask you to just come right here. And we're going to take a look at what we have on the communion table today. Yeah, just come right up front here so we can see it better. Today is what I would call a stop day. If you were driving with the car to church, whoever was driving the car, there's a sign in traffic. It's called a stop sign. And when you're going to take driver's lessons one day, they are going to tell you, the teacher is going to tell you, that all four wheels have to come to a complete stop. Now, if you've been driving for a while, you might not be observing that. Go ahead.
I see stop signs from all the worlds.
From all the worlds, yeah. Yeah, they have them everywhere. You're right. Stop signs are international. They have them everywhere. They look the same. You're absolutely right. And it means that all four wheels have to come to a stop, and the person has to look around and make sure that before they cross, that they really have the right to do so at that moment. Well, today is a stop day in church, because today we're stopping at one point of the worship service, and we're remembering something that Jesus said we should do. Could we go to the slide, please? Which is two elements, two parts to this. We have, what is this?
Bread.
And then what do we have here? Grape juice, that's right. Jesus used these two signs and said, this is a sign for you to remember how I laid down my life for you because I love you so much. Let's go to the next slide. Jesus was celebrating this meal with his disciples. How many disciples did he have? 12. He had 12 disciples, and they were sitting around that table, and they were listening to what he said. So today we remember Jesus' sacrifice and how he died for us on the cross. Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, we thank you that you put up a stop sign, even for us in church, where we need to consciously look to you and give thanks for your love that you have demonstrated and show us every new day. Help us to live in it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, thank you very much. You may be seated. All right. At this time, was there anybody who celebrated a birthday? And I need a volunteer again. Who's going to help me today? Who's going to help me today? Come on, come on. Oh, I had two volunteers. Come on, you join us too. Come on. We're not going to exclude you. You come right here and you can do it together. All right, so who had a birthday? Right back there. Come on, let's go and make sure we say happy birthday.
The bank didn't have enough ones, so we used a check.
Okay, good. Thank you so much. Well, Lord God, we just pray for our sister here that as she's celebrating her birthday, that you bless that birthday and that you make it very evident again for her anew in her life how much you love and care for her and her family. In Jesus' name, amen. Anybody else? Well, if not, let's carry that all the way to the front and maybe we can put it in a special place there. God, you guys are such good helpers. Let's see. Let's put it right over here. We're just going to put it right here. Right there. Thank you so much. Let's give him a hand. Okay, so at this time, I'm going to just ask for you to call out any celebrations or concerns that you have, and we're going to unite in prayer over those. I have One thing I wanted to share with you, Joan Hanley, she had an accident this week, and she was first moved to rehab, and then I found out yesterday evening that she was also then transferred from there back to Venice Hospital. She's going to be treated there and then go back to rehab at that point when she's strong enough to do so. So we pray for her and her recovery from that accident that she had. And then also Shirley Heckman, she is in rehab at this time at Port Charlotte Rehab. And anybody else that I'm forgetting? Geneva Morse, she is also at a rehab center, and hopefully she'll be able to go home soon. Okay, anything else? Yes, go ahead, please.
I'm just still celebrating my son. He's doing so well, and I thank you all for the prayers. The previous celebration, we're at the finals, but things are looking very good.
That's wonderful. Paul, we continue to pray for him. Yes. Doug? Oh, okay. Go ahead. Well, we're going to just completely hang on to God for an exciting ride, because he's going to make it happen. He's going to make it happen through us. We're his vessels, and we're trusting him for all the details. So, okay, great. Thank you, Barbara. Go ahead. Yes, we all do. And I also wanted to welcome Ruth Abels, who is in our midst. And I just want you to know that we're so glad you are here. It's so wonderful. Can I give you a hug?
Yeah. Glad to be here. Hope to be here again sometime.
Yes, sometime real soon. That's great. All right. How many of you have an unspoken request this morning? Please raise your hand and signify it. So let's stand together. Hold your neighbor's hand, and we're going to pray together. Lord God, we are here as your people, and we know that it is only by your Holy Spirit that anything can take place in our midst. It's that dynamo, that dynamis, that power that makes things come to fruition in the life of the individual Christian and the body of Christ. And we thank you, Lord, that you are our healer, you are our comforter, you are our hiding place, you are our provider, you are the light of the world. And Lord, whatever needs are present, we thank you that you are taking care of them, and that we can take all your promises as ours today. And we thank you that we can be in your house today. In Jesus' name, we pray for all the things that people have brought with them in their hearts today, that you would take care of it and shed your light on it in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, so you may be seated. At this time, we are going to have a gathering of our tithes and offerings. And during the offering, Betty Van Tassel is going to sing for us, "Not a Sparrow Falleth."
Not a leaf that wavers. precious surely than the birds that fly. Is a father's image to a father's eye. Give thyself to Jesus, trust him full and free. Cast thy cares before him, and he'll care for thee. For the God that planted in thy breast a soul, on his sacred tablets doth thy name enroll. Cheer thine heart, then tremble. Never faithless be. He that marks the sparrow
Lord God, we just thank you for that song that Betty sang to us and that wonderful assurance that he that marks the sparrow will surely remember us. What an assurance for us today to count on those blessings and your loving care in our lives, not just on Sunday morning, but every single moment of our lives. And we just thank you for that assurance today. We pray that these offerings would be a blessing to many. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. Amen. Let's give Betty a hand one more time. You may be seated. As you know, this week is coming up the anniversary of that day, 9/11/2001, which I'm sure that all of us remember where we were at on that day. And again, we want to remind you that some of the slides may be disturbing for younger children, so we leave it up to the discretion of the parents. I'm going to read scripture from Isaiah 41, verses 8 through 10, and then 17 through 20 before we see the slides. But you, Israel, my servant Jacob, whom I have chosen, you descendants of Abraham, my friend, I took you from the ends of the earth, from its farthest corners I called you. I said, you are my servant. I have chosen you and have not rejected you. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. The poor and the needy search for water, but there is none. Their tongues are parched with thirst, but I, the Lord, will answer them. I, the God of Israel, will not forsake them. I will make rivers flow on barren heights and springs within the valleys. I will turn the desert into pools of water, and a parched ground in springs. I will put in the desert the cedar and the acacia, the myrtle and the olive. I will set junipers in the wasteland, the fir and the cypress together, so that the people may see and know, may consider and understand that the hand of the Lord has done this, that the Holy One of Israel has created it. And so today, as we remember the lives of those that were lost on that day, I just heard the number again the other night, 2,977 lives were lost on that day. And so we remember them, and we remember the loved ones that to this day live with the consequences of that day. Let's take a moment to pray. Lord, we pray for families that are still, and for all of us, Lord, for your mercy to rest upon us, for your grace to be with us. And yes, you are the God of all comfort. And we pray that your Holy Spirit would guide and lead us as your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us stand and sing together our national anthem.
The scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 8, verses 36 through 40, from the Message Bible. As they continued down the road, they came to a stream of water. The eunuch said, "Here's water. Why can't I be baptized?" He ordered the chariot to stop. They both went down to the water, and Philip baptized him on the spot. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of God suddenly took Philip off, and that was the last the eunuch saw of him. But he didn't mind. He had what he'd come for, and he went down the road as happy as he could be. Philip showed up in Azotus and continued north, preaching the message in all the villages along that route until he arrived in Caesarea. And so ends the reading.
Thank you, Lynn. Let's bow our heads one more time and just turn to Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you that it is your light that shines into our lives, and we pray that it would shine strongly on your word this morning and what it contains for us today. In Jesus' name, all disturbing thoughts, feelings, and emotions we purposefully now put aside. No matter what our week looked like, we are just focusing on you and trusting that you have a word for us today. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you were here with us last week, you will recall that Philip the evangelist was asked to witness to a man of considerable importance. He goes and hurries to the Ethiopian, and we can clearly see God's timing in that. I think it's very important for us to keep our eyes on the fact that God's timing is perfect and that he is the one who directs the steps of the believer. And why was it so perfect? Because the Ethiopian had by now gotten to the point where he was reading Isaiah 53, and Isaiah 53 underlines for us what I tried to convey to the children this morning about the Lamb of God laying his life down for the sins of the world. And Jesus, it's an image of Christ who stands silently in front of his accusers. Now, the Ethiopian man was an educated person who had no problems understanding the words that he was reading in Isaiah that day. But one thing that he did struggle with was the message that was behind it. And I said that so many times that, you know, it's really important that when you come here on Sunday morning that you are prayed up. Because you know what the word says? The word says that the devil goes around like a roaring lion to see who he can devour. And what does that mean? That we have a very real enemy. You know, the devil isn't happy when you are in church. The devil isn't happy when you are growing in your faith. The devil isn't happy when there's unity in a church. He's going to try to do anything to disturb us from growing in our relationship with God. And so you and I need to be prayed up when we come in on Sunday mornings that the seed that's being sown into our lives truly would bring forth fruit. And you know, that's also important because there are, even during church, there can be many distractions. Right? There can be many distractions. I mean, your eye might get hung up on, oh, that microphone is hanging crooked this morning, or, our attention gets drawn away from what really matters. So maybe you have come to church today with a heavy heart. Maybe you are overburdened with responsibilities, and my news to you today is that you are in the right place. Why am I saying that? Because the eunuch, too, was seeking help in the right place. What was he reading? He was reading the Torah. He was reading one of the Old Testament prophets, Isaiah, prophesying about the coming of the Christ. And isn't that what we heard in that song about the sparrow, that not a single sparrow falleth God without God knowing it? So God knows about every detail about your life. He knows everything. And so you can bring those burdens and those heavy loads that are on your mind today and put them before God. And so it was for this eunuch too, that he was at a crisis point in his life, right? But it became a turning point. And Philip is obeying God's call, and he's introducing Christ to this man, a total stranger. You know, sometimes we think, oh, well, you know, I mean, we have to know somebody well enough in order to be a witness about Christ's love. That might be a plus, but it's not always possible. Sometimes people are placed into our path that are there for that moment, for that purpose, for that moment in time. And like I said a few weeks ago, it might never repeat itself. And if I don't buy out that moment, it will never happen again. And, you know, this morning as I was getting ready, I was listening to the book of Acts, and it's interesting that Philip is mentioned in other passages, but before he ever gets to the eunuch, Philip the evangelist, was doing mighty works for God. He was casting out demons, the scripture says. God was using him to do mighty signs in the name of God, which would include healings and all kinds of things. So Philip was being used in many ways before he ever got to this point. And you know, not everything is so glamorous about ministry. This moment here when the choir sings and Mike plays the instrument and I'm up here preaching and all of this is just a little snippet of time in a moment of a life of a Christian. Everything else is lived the many hours and many days before we get here on Sunday morning, when our faith is being tested, when we are growing in our relationship, and when it shows, do we really believe what we are saying? You know, I'm being tested in my faith every day. I can walk away from this pulpit, and I know God is going to call into account what I have said, and I must myself believe it. I can't just preach it, right? And the same for you. You can't just listen to it, but we have to live by it. And you know, and once we hear it, this is the dangerous part about going to church. Did you know it was dangerous to go to church? It is. Because you see, once you know the truth, we are responsible. Once we know what the right thing is to do and we're not doing it, the scripture says it's sin unto you if you don't. So let's look up Acts 8:36. We're not looking it up. Acts 8:36, please. Okay. So as they continued down the road, they came to a stream of water. The eunuch said, "Here's water. Why can't I be baptized?" All right? The eunuch had gone to Jerusalem and found in Jerusalem not what he was looking for. But Philip shows up, and all of a sudden, the search of his life comes to an end. You know, we all want to be happy. We all want to live fulfilled lives. We all want to be blessed. And those are the promises that come with following Christ. However, the bottom line is that once we have come to Christ, the very basic search of life has ended. Because we have found the meaning of life in Christ. Everything else will just fall into place and is a little sideline to what really matters. His life was culminating in this point. I can tell you that I did not live before I knew Christ. I existed, but I didn't live. So it all comes together for him, and faith calls for a public confession. All right? And he knows that, and Philip must have said something to him, because isn't that what he says? He said, well, here's water. Why can't I be baptized? Why shouldn't I be? What's holding me back? And baptism was only something that was an outer expression of an inner thing that had already taken place, that had already happened. So at last his search was over. All of his life had been preparation for this moment. You know, I really firmly believe that. We cannot say Jesus and a gazillion other things in my life. Jesus only. And then everything else will fall into place. He was an educated man. He, after all, knew how to read the Torah. He was a scholar of sorts because he could read it even in its original language. His high position made it possible for him to travel far distances. He had the money to buy the scroll and the money to travel that distance. And he had come to the city where Jesus was going to be crucified. He had a hunger deep down, and he was saying on the inside, more please. Did you know that nothing is wasted in our lives? God can use everything and every circumstance, from the cradle to the grave. God can make things useful in our lives. And for what purpose? To lead us to himself. I can look back at my life, and I know many of you can, where all the circumstances of my life just came together so that I would finally surrender to God and look up unto him and say, I don't have any other options. And I'm so glad that that happened in my life. You know? That God was my only option. Because I knew deep down in my heart that without God, I was completely lost. And the eunuch knew that too. Because here it comes to that culmination, and he is turning to God. And yes, God can use all those things, advancement and adversity, joy and sorrow, gain and loss, for the purpose to bring us closer to himself. But let me just say one thing, that not all the things that are happening in our lives are orchestrated by God, but he can use the circumstances in our lives to bring good out of it. Look into church history and you'll figure out that a lot of things that have been put onto God's slate had nothing to do with God. Like the Crusades, right? Said, in the name of God, we're going to go and convert people. And God was not behind it. God had nothing to do with it. So we're giving credit to God in certain areas that has nothing to do with God. It's our own choices that have brought us to that point. But God is powerful enough, despite our choices, to bring good out of it. Does that make sense? Well, I'm glad you are excited too. Yeah, all right? So he says, I'm going to go and get baptized today. That's what he said. There's water. I'm just going to do it. I'm going to express my faith. That's what faith is for, to live it out. All right? To live it out and to stand on the promises that God has given us. And you know, by the way, that's not always very easy, because you might have people around you that are discouraging you from trusting God. And so I'm encouraging you to not listen to those voices, but to listen to God's voice. And when he says something, you just better do it. Acts 8:37, all right? It says, here's water, why can't I be baptized? He ordered the chariot to stop. Another stop moment. I can't continue. I have to stop and I have to do this now. You know, when we see a painting, we recognize the painter expresses something of what he saw, felt, and experienced. So this eunuch had seen something, he had felt something, he had experienced something, and now he was stepping out in faith and giving his faith expression. All right? He was giving his faith expression. What's in the heart will come out of the mouth. Eventually. Garbage in, garbage out. God's word in, God's word out. So in Romans 10:9, this is what the scripture says. It's the word of faith that welcomes God to go to work and set things right for us. This is the core of our preaching. Say the welcoming word to God. Jesus is my master, embracing body and soul. God's work of doing in us what he did in raising Jesus from the dead. That's it. You are not doing anything. You're simply calling out to God, trusting him to do it for you. That's salvation. You're not earning it. You know, I mean, we could, and I don't know what our background is, but sometimes we can be put into a system, even within the church. And if you haven't been in church this Sunday, I don't know about you then. Going to church doesn't make us a Christian, friends. Like one Christian singer said, going to McDonald's doesn't make me a hamburger. Right? Just by warming the pew, I'm not a Christian. But it all comes down to how we live out our faith. It gives expression. And that's what he said. That's what salvation. I just accept the gift of God that he has given me, and I'm trusting him that he is the one who will bring it to pass, who will bring it to a completion. So this was an inward experience that he had and a commitment that he made, and now he's showing it on the outside. He's showing he's believing what he was reading in Isaiah. Because, you know, by him being baptized that one day, let me just tell you this. This is really important. By him being baptized that day, he identifies himself with a reject. Right? Jesus in that image of Isaiah is no winner to the human eye. You know, we look at that and said he was rejected, he was despised, he was put on a cross and he died. And, you know, and he says, I want to be identified with him. That's great, isn't it? Because we are acknowledging what Jesus accomplished that day. Acts 8:39. It says, when they came up out of the water, they both went down to the water, and Philip baptized him on the spot. On the spot. And then going on further, it says, when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of God suddenly took Philip off, and that was the last the eunuch saw of him. That was the last the eunuch saw of him. So he's still dripping wet with the baptism water, right? I mean, he was immersed in the river, and he's coming out, and he probably wants to say something to Philip, and whoop, he's gone. And I always wondered about that, why God did that, you know? And I tell you, there's two things that I can think of. Number one is that when he turned around and Philip was gone, and I don't know about you, but I have no problem believing it. You know, God can do that. He can do that. He told Philip to go there. Now he said, your job is done. I'm removing you out of that situation. I guarantee you that that eunuch knew God showed up. Don't you think? Yeah. That Philip didn't walk and disappear on the horizon somewhere, but he was gone in an instant. And so the eunuch looked at that and said, boy, God just showed up here. Something big happened and I didn't just dream it. You know? He didn't have to double guess himself, but it was a real thing. And then the other thing too is that mentors, do you know what, we all know what a mentor is, right? We have mentors in our church here. When new members join our church, we have, what do you call them? Sponsors, is that? Yeah, sponsors. They have a mentor role. They're mentoring the new members in our congregation. They're mentoring them in their faith and in their growing up in Christ. But mentors don't stay around forever. And so Philip and his role as a mentor didn't stay and hang around forever. The time came when the eunuch had to go back to where he came from, and he became a witness to all of the goodness of God, and he witnessed to his own people about what God had done in his life. And then I love the last part where it says, God suddenly took Philip off, and that was the last the eunuch saw of him, but he didn't mind. He had what he had come for and went on down the road as happy as he could be. Hallelujah, right? I mean, he was fulfilled in his faith, and he walked away a different person. And I am telling you right now, be on the alert. When you walk out these doors, you better believe that the devil is going to try to test you. He is going to ask you, do you really believe what you have heard on Sunday morning? Do you really believe that this is something that transforms and changes people's hearts and lives, and it's for the good? All right? But also to add to that, you don't have to live in fear, but you have to be alert. And you know when I have to be most alert? When I'm tired physically. Isn't that when we get irritable? It's like, you know, it's like, oh no, not that again. You have to put your weapons on, you know? You have to be equipped for the day. And when I'm extra tired, I have to be extra prayed up, you know? Because it's amazing what will come your way if you're not prayed up and if you're not prepared, all right? And so he went on rejoicing. Joy is the outcome of an encounter with God. That's another thing is, we should be joyous people. We should have the joy of the Lord. Isn't that what the scripture says? That the joy of the Lord is our strength. I can be physically feeble, but still have joy in my heart and have the joy of the Lord as my strength. So he went back to Ethiopia, and he was witnessing for God. Now, a little history lesson here, which I'm sure you are aware of. Matthew 5:9 is a scripture that has been quoted many times before. These words have been used by many to underline what most of us know so well, that peace is essential for living. Many consider the Camp David Peace Accord as one of President Jimmy Carter's greatest achievements. And, you know, the reason why I look at that is just recently I came across a speech that he gave before the joint session of Congress on September 18, 1978, where he announced the success of 13 days of peace negotiations between Israel and one of his Arab neighbors, Egypt. He had to pause 25 times for applause. And he was looking up into the balcony at Anwar el-Sadat, Egyptian president, and Menachem Begin, Israeli prime minister. And a clearly emotional Jimmy Carter said this by quoting Jesus' words from the Bible, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God." And that said it all. That said it all. And yes, indeed, I believe that Philip that day was a true peacemaker, because didn't he bring peace as a vessel of God into the heart of the searching person? I wonder how many searching people we have outside these doors and sometimes inside these doors. I came here searching today, didn't you? For this peace that God offers on a silver platter, it's all for our taking. And in final conclusion, let me read to you verse 40. Last verse, Philip showed up in Azotus and continued north, preaching the message in all the villages along the route until he arrived in Caesarea. Azotus was the name of an old Philistine city of Ashdod, north of Gaza. Philip continued to preach the word up the coast region until he reached Caesarea. This city had been built by Herod the Great, named after Caesar Augustus. It was the center of the Roman administration in Palestine, and it was a thoroughly Gentile city. Cornelius, the Roman centurion, was stationed here, and Peter would lead that man to become a Christian so that the Gentile church would be born. So Philip was there in this region, part of this new move of God, and Philip seems to have quite comfortably settled in Caesarea. In Acts 21, 8 through 9, oh gosh, 21. It says, a short run from Tyre to Ptolemais completed the voyage. We greeted our Christian friends here and stayed with them a day. In the morning, we went on to Caesarea and stayed with Philip, the evangelist, one of the seven. Philip had four daughters who prophesied, four grown daughters who followed the Lord. And you know what? I just want to encourage you that your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, your influence over them as a Christian is immeasurably powerful. Your prayer for them every night, your prayer for them during the week, and every time you point to God in their lives, God will honor it. It's a planted seed. And so let's stand and pray as we give thanks today. Lord God, we just thank you so much for Philip and his obedience. We thank you that you are in charge over our lives, that no matter what comes against us, no matter what tests us, you are always bigger, always greater. And we just thank you that you are here in our midst today. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. All right. And in response, let us sing together 346, There is Within My Heart a Melody. Thank you. You may be seated. Aren't you glad I know my Bible? No screen, no problem. It's right here. I can look it up. All right. So we are here to celebrate communion and to remember what Christ has done for us. The Lord Jesus, the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, after he had supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, and as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you show the Lord's death till he comes again. Let's bow our heads and each of us individually confess our sins to him and ask him for forgiveness. Lord God, we thank you for that promise that's in your word that says, if we confess our sins to you, you are just and you are more than willing to forgive us those sins based on your grace, and we are accepted in faith in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us confess our faith by saying the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We will first hand out the broken body of Christ, the bread. Please hold on to the element, and we will take it together, and we will do the same with the cup. body of Christ broken for us. This is the cup of the new covenant based on the promises of Jesus Christ. Let us bow our heads and pray. Lord, with thanksgiving in our hearts and expressing it through our words, we turn to you, we worship you, and we praise and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing our closing hymn, number 321, verses 1, 3, and 5, When We Walk with the Lord. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus now and forever. Amen.